listeners, this is another episode of Ladies Digest on AAU TV. In our previous episode, we talked about the PAP and the HPV test, how necessary it is for you to go for a test, and we highlighted reasons and some symptoms and how you can get the HPV, the virus, which are numerous. According to our doctor, she said you have over 100 virus HPV, so you need to really go for one test or a pap smear. So on this episode, we'll be looking at, you've gotten your result, you've gone for a test, what is the interpretation and the management of the HPV? And as usual, I have in my studio our regular guest, Dr. Udell Tego of the Luka Health Medical Center at East Legon. Welcome, Doc.
Thank you.
It's nice seeing you again.
Happy to be here as always.
All right. Thank you for coming, as Thank usual. You. And we talked about the pap smear in yes. our previous episode, the HPV, and you mentioned a lot and you really delved into many areas. And I know our viewers, they've been challenged to go for their test.
Challenge is good.
Yeah, they've been challenged. I, for one, have been challenged.
Excellent.
Yeah. So now we've gotten, they've gone for their test and the result is out. How should it be managed? And in that regard, I want to know what an abnormal pap test or an HPV result looks like or means.
Okay. So in general, having an abnormal pap test result or a positive HPV test result does not by any means mean that you have or will get cervical cancer.
Oh, okay.
I think it's extremely important to start
to
with
that.
And to stress that,
that
because immediately people hear the word cancer for one. Even if the word pre or the prefix pre is before it.
It's still scary.
Once you hear cancer, it's scary and understandably so.
Yeah, yeah.
So again, the PAP test, the HPV test are screening tests. They just raise a red flag indicating to your doctor to take a closer look, possibly do additional testing to see if there are indeed any abnormalities of the cervical cells in the case of the PAP test. Or if the HPV is present, determine if they are starting to cause any concerning, specifically precancerous changes on the cervix. But when you have an abnormal test, it just means additional testing, additional evaluation needs to be done. It does not mean that you have or will even get cervical cancer.
Okay, so can I relate it to the breast cancer? I know there are sometimes you go for a test for breast cancer. We are not talking breast cancer yet, but just like to relate it.
Yes.
There are sometimes you go for a test for breast cancer and they refer you for a mammogram.
Yes.
And at times they tell you that there are some, is it lumps or that they are benign or
yes.
something like that.
Yes.
Are they benign? Should I say cells or results when it comes to the HPV?
Yes, they can. There can be changes that can be considered benign.
Okay,
so let's get more into what type of result can you get from a PAP test.
Okay.
With the HPV test, either it's present or it's absent.
Okay.
Either the virus is there or it's not.
Okay.
With the PAP test, there's three different results you can get. The first test is negative. That means that the cells of the cervix appear completely normal, and that's it.
Okay.
The second result can be unsatisfactory. Unsatisfactory doesn't really tell us anything. What it means is that for whatever reason, they were not able to read the results.
Yeah.
Sometimes that can be because there weren't enough cells obtained on the initial PAP test.
Okay.
One reason that can be, and just to give an example, is that sometimes women in menopause, the cervical cells can change such that it's harder to get a good sample of cells because the skin is thinner and maybe drier after menopause.
Yeah.
So it can be a little more challenging to get enough cells
to
on that type of swab. That's one type of reason where there may not be enough cells. Or sometimes you get the cells, but sometimes during the processing in the lab that they need to do to be able to read a result, the cells don't just survive the processing.
Wow, so it's possible.
It's possible.
They'll die off.
Sometimes. Not that they die off per se, but let's say you only got a few sample of the cells or, you know, whatever processing or solutions they use to read the results, the cells don't survive that. And so usually in the unsatisfactory test result instance, you just need to come back and have the test repeated.
Okay.
So that way we can try and get a more adequate sample. Third result you can get is an abnormal.
Okay.
Again, abnormal doesn't mean that you have cancer. It doesn't mean that you're going to get cancer.
Okay.
But the types of abnormality, the way they're called, the term used for them is a very long term, which I will say, but I'll give an abbreviation to make it easier.
Yeah, okay.
The types of abnormalities described on a Pap test are called squamous intraepithelial lesions, or SIL, which is much simpler for all of us, including me, to say.
I think I'll go with the SIL because I can't even remember.
Yes. And it's not necessarily really to remember, but frequently these days, at the same time that a doctor gets the result for the Pap test, the patient also gets the result for the Pap test through advances in technology, you know, which we all benefit from.
Yeah.
You can get your actual printout of your result. And so when you see something like a long word like that, it's helpful to have an understanding that, number one, this is not horrible, you're not going to die, the world is not going to end, but this is what it can mean. So any abnormality on the cervix is described as SIL. Within the SIL, there are two categories of SIL. There can be low-grade SIL, which generally means there are mild changes seen or mild abnormalities seen. The high-grade is the second category of SIL, and it's those that are more concerning. Those are the ones that are most likely associated with an HPV, a high-risk HPV infection.
Okay.
And those high-grade SIL changes are the ones that are more likely to develop to pre-cancer or cancer.
Okay, okay.
With the low-risk category of SIL, sometimes it could be because of HPV and it's just starting to cause minor abnormalities. Sometimes it could be nothing. Remember I said that there are false positive results?
Results, yeah.
Sometimes your Pap may say there's low-grade SIL present, but then you go to do the additional testing, which we'll get into, and then you don't see anything.
Anything.
Exactly. So those are the terms used to describe abnormalities seen on a Pap test.
Pap test. Mm-hmm. Okay. So with the HPV, are there different types of HPV?
Yes. Okay. So we covered in the previous episode.
Yeah, the 100 and something.
There's more than 100 types, but they're grouped into two categories.
Oh, okay, two categories.
Yes, low
risk
types and
high
risk types. For our purpose of discussing the cervical cancer screening, the cause of cervical cancer, and the Pap test, we're concerned only with the high risk types of HPV. Yes.
Oh, I see. And what are some of the problems these HPVs can cause?
So the HPV, we're talking about the cervical cancer, the high risk,
the cervical cancer.
And then the low risk type can cause genital warts.
Okay.
With the high risk HPV, it's actually good that you asked that question again, because high risk HPV can also cause other types of cancer, not necessarily related to discussion about the Pap test, because that's for the cervix.
Okay.
But high risk HPV has also been known to cause other cancers of the general genital area or the anal area, so anal cancer.
Apart from the cervical.
Yes, cancer. Yes. So high risk HPV has been associated with anal cancer.
Okay.
High risk HPV can also cause vulvar cancer, so not necessarily of the cervix, which is the openings of the womb, but also the outer vaginal lips or the vagina itself, can develop cancer related to HPV, but also cancers of the head and neck. The mouth and throat in particular have also been associated with high-risk HPV.
Wow. So what was the relationship?
We'll get into that a little bit later.
I see. Okay.
We'll talk more about HPV and how you acquire it, and then it'll become apparent how the high-risk HPV can be associated with these other types.
With this kind of types. Okay,
exactly.
So still more on the HPV now. So how can it be acquired?
So in general, HPV is acquired sexually or by skin-to-skin contact.
Okay.
High-risk HPV, like I said, is sexually acquired, and so the main way to prevent it is to try and be selective with your sexual partners, know the sexual history of your partners, and to use barrier methods, specifically condoms, to try and protect against, you know, HPV infection. There's also the HPV vaccines, which are available, which can also offer protection against the most common types of low-risk and high-risk HPV, that can cause genital warts and cervical cancer, respectively.
So if you mention, okay, you should be selective with partners, for a married lady or a married couple,
yes,
you are stuck with that partner.
Stuck with.
You are stuck with the partner.
You're happily stuck with that partner, hopefully.
Happily stuck with, though. But now you are stuck with, and what should you do?
So it's interesting because there are instances where a married woman, or let's give a simple example of a newly married couple.
Okay. Yeah.
They're monogamous with just each other for X duration of time.
Time.
But prior to that, they may have been sexually active with others, which is common. It's normal.
Sure.
In general. So it could be the case that an HPV may have been acquired by the male or the female prior to their current partner that they're married to. Like I said earlier, HPV many times can get cleared from the body.
Yeah,
but there's also another instance where the HPV can be in the body but not cause any symptoms.
Okay.
It's not causing any precancerous changes on the cervix. The woman's getting tested, the pap tests are negative. In that case, we say that the HPV is just lying dormant or inactive in the person's cells, okay? But then at a certain point, let's say the woman is the one who has acquired the HPV.
Yeah.
At a certain point, she'll have a pap test after she's been married that comes up positive. It could be the case that this is an HPV infection that has been dormant in the system for a while. And maybe let's assume the woman is age 35. You know, as women get older, as we get older in general, it becomes harder for our immune system to clear the HPV virus as readily, which is why the co-testing is recommended for women age 30 and over. Okay, I'm trying to tie everything together that we discussed.
Yeah.
So because of that, maybe now at this point she's gone for a pap test and now it's showing that the HPV is there.
Is there.
Does it mean that she has to suspect that her partner is not faithful?
I see.
Not necessarily.
Yeah, yeah.
And one should never jump right to that conclusion. Because sometimes HPV can be dormant in the system without causing symptoms for a while before it starts to show. The other instance may be, okay, same couple, they've gotten married, but they've had other sexual partners previously. If the woman's pap test comes back positive all of a sudden, it could be the case that she did acquire it from her husband. But still in that case, it's not necessarily that her husband is being unfaithful. Again, same that applies to her in terms of the HPV being dormant in her system, same can apply to him.
Yeah,
maybe the HPV has been dormant in his system for a while, and it's only just now that it's manifesting that he's transmitted it to his partner or his wife. So I say that to say that, again, never jump the gun and make an assumption in terms of the faithfulness of a partner until, you know, thorough investigations can be held with regard to. And obviously, on a personal side, on the couple side, obviously, hopefully communication lines are open, they have a relationship such that they can discuss things so that everyone is open about the past history how it could impact health, you know, in the present time.
That is true. So how long, if a couple or a lady finds out she has this HPV, is it forever?
It's not forever.
Okay. So there's hope.
Absolutely.
I thought once you have it, you are doomed.
No. Okay. And in most cases, even if you get HPV infection, even if you have precancerous changes on the cervix, you're usually not doomed.
Okay.
More often than not, you're absolutely not doomed.
Okay.
HPV, again, is an extremely common infection. Okay. Estimates put the percentage around 70 to 80% of sexually active men and women will acquire HPV infection in their lifetime. But almost an equal percentage of healthy men and women will clear the infection on their own without any consequence. Okay. However, even if you acquire an HPV infection as a woman, and it's to the point where there are some low grade, or in certain instances, even some high grade changes detected with the pap smear, as long as you're able to catch it before the stage of actual cervical cancer, in the case of high grade changes, you can remove those abnormal cells or HPV infected cells okay. from the cervix.
Okay.
And then with surveillance, we can check to see if indeed all the affected cells are removed and the pap smear and the HPV tests then go back to normal and negative.
Okay.
So by and large, an HPV infection tends not to be forever.
Forever.
Right.
Okay. And what are some of the, what are the treatments, what treatments can be prescribed by your, or would it have to do with your individual, the individuality of the lady or the couple in terms of treatments?
Yes. So in general, when it comes to abnormal changes on the pap smear, the treatment will vary based on each individual circumstance.
Okay.
So the information we're giving here is just general information to help facilitate understanding
yeah.
of the different possibilities and the different evaluation methods that will be employed.
Okay. Yeah.
But your doctor will determine what is based on you based on current evidence-based guidelines
yeah.
and your yes. specific test results. So in order to answer that more thoroughly, we need to get more into, okay, now that we know the terms used to describe abnormal pap test results, what is done with those and what additional tests are carried out to evaluate those? Because again, we need to check to make sure that the pap test was correct. Okay. So when you have any abnormality seen on the cervix, if it falls into the low grade SIL category, these more often than not tend to be in the mild range of categories, meaning if there's any abnormality on the cervix, they tend to be mild if they're classified as low grade by the PAP.
Okay.
The test that's typically utilized to check and actually diagnose if the PAP was correct and actually give a proper verification of exactly what extent of change is present on the cervix is called a colposcopy. That's also a kind of long word.
Colposcopy.
And we'll try and insert some diagrams or pictures with the word, exactly, with the term spelled out so you can see. Yes. So the colposcopy is a special test that is done in the GYN office.
Yeah.
You generally don't need anesthesia for it.
Okay.
It takes about 15 minutes on average. It's not
okay.
very long.
Okay.
And it's a way to look at the cervix, get a magnified view of the cervical cells with a special magnifying device. So it's basically, a colposcope is basically a microscope for the cervix.
Oh, okay.
So it helps to highlight the cervical cells. There's certain solutions and whatnot which we, you know, use to actually visualize the possible abnormalities a bit better. And in addition to the colposcopy, we also generally do a biopsy. A biopsy is just a tissue sample. So we usually snip a tiny piece of tissue. Whenever I say biopsy, people think that here I come with the knife and I'm gonna slice a big chunk of tissue. No. It sounds scary, but that's the reason we're having this discussion.
Yeah, this
so
discussion.
When you take a biopsy, it's usually a very small sample of cells. That's usually all you need.
So it's still like the pap smear?
It's a little bit different. So there are different instruments that we use to obtain the biopsy because instead of now just swabbing or brushing the surface of the cervix, we're actually just pinching a little piece of tissue. It's very tiny. And usually we take more than one biopsy. But again, like I said, the whole test takes less than 15 minutes. So it's not very involved at all. The instruments are designed to be able to take the tissue very quickly and relatively painlessly. Sometimes you might feel a little bit of a cramp or you might just feel uncomfortable because the speculum is in when this is being done.
Okay.
But it's very quick, tiny pieces of tissue that we can actually send to the lab. So then the pathologist, which is the physician that is trained to read these tissue samples, can actually look at the tissue and say, yes, there are actually abnormal changes there, and they can grade the extent of the abnormality. So when you get a colposcopy with biopsy, there are a different set of terms that will describe what they see on the biopsy.
Okay. Okay.
So either they'll say the biopsy is negative, meaning they don't see any cervical abnormalities at all.
Okay.
Next, they may say we see mild precancerous changes, or not even precancerous, they'll just say we'll see mild changes present.
Okay.
These changes are termed cervical intraepithelial neoplasia, or CIN.
I like the CIN.
Yes.
We like the CIN.
So the CIN category of changes refer to the biopsy results, whereas the SIL, low-grade and high-grade, refer to the pap test results. So CIN1 is
so
just...
it's more like an advanced...
It's not advanced.
Okay.
It's mild.
Mild, okay.
Exactly. So these changes have a very low likelihood of progressing on to cervical cancer.
Okay.
So that's why it's just a 1,
yeah.
CIN1. Yeah. CIN1 most of the time goes away on its own.
Okay.
And usually you just need follow-up with repeat pap testing at a certain interval determined by your doctor to see if your body's able to clear it on its own, which again, most of the time it does.
It does.
Okay. So CIN, if you want to correlate it back to the pap test results, CIN usually goes along with low-grade SIL. Okay, so these all fall into the mild category, less likely to follow on or to progress on to cervical cancer. Okay. Next, you have CIN2 and CIN3. CIN2 is moderate abnormality of the cervical cells. CIN3 is severe abnormality of the cervical cells. CIN2 and CIN3 are considered precancerous because these have a higher chance of progressing to cervical cancer. Your body is less able to clear these types of abnormalities. These changes correlate to the high-grade SIL, which can be identified on the pap test. Okay, and so that describes what is done when you get any low-grade or SIL test result on the pap test. You get either colposcopy with or without biopsy, but most docs, the recommendations usually recommend biopsy. Even if you're looking with a microscope and you don't see any major abnormality that stands out at you, it's usually prudent to still get some tissue samples just to make
sure,
because the tissue samples are diagnostic. So that way you can make sure that indeed there is not something there, or if there is something there, you can get an accurate assessment of the severity. And then the biopsy results are the CIN terms that are used. And it's mild, CIN1, CIN2 moderate, or CIN3 severe. The CIN2 and CIN3 are most concerning because those are actual precancerous cells that could progress to cervical cancer.
Wow. Mm-hmm. So these pap tests, how are they evaluated?
The way we just discussed. So when you have the pap test done, you get the result. If there's an abnormality, it says that there's SIL present, then usually your doctor, based on your particular circumstance, will tell you if you need to then have the colposcopy with biopsy. And then based on the colposcopy with biopsy results, then you'll know if you need further treatment. Or not.
So can... You mentioned in our earlier conversation, you talked about the dormant HPV.
Yes.
Can they get to this CIN? Those are what gets to the CIN.
In some cases.
Okay.
Like I said, most of the time, the body can clear the HPV.
And when it doesn't clear, it's...
Then it can possibly progress on to the CIN changes. But it's not absolute. Just because it's there. Usually if it's dormant, you won't even get an abnormal result on the testing.
Because
dormant means your immune system is suppressing it. So it's
suppressing.
Not active. It's not causing any active changes.
I see.
But sometimes, in certain instances, yes, they can become active and progress to cause changes.
And
again, highlighting the need for coming for a routine
check. So when these results have been evaluated, what's next?
So let's say a woman has low-grade SIL suspected on her pap. They have colposcopy and biopsy done, and the result is CIN1. And I am oversimplifying, so there may be various types of people viewing our conversation right now. There's many, many different results and circumstances and different things which will mandate a different management. But I'm just trying to make things simple just for comprehension's sake. So low-grade SIL on pap, you've had the colposcopy and biopsy, and your result comes back as either no abnormality or CIN1, mild changes. Usually in that case, you just need to come back for repeat pap and HPV, which is the co-testing, in 1 year
on average.
Yes.
For any age, like within the age?
For any age.
Yeah.
unless for whatever reason, based on your history, your doctor determines otherwise. And there can be cases where your doctor may determine the need for a different evaluation. But in general, for any age, if that is how your pap test, your biopsy results come out, you get a repeat pap with HPV testing in 1 year. If you have any of the high grade changes, CIN2 or CIN3, moderate or severe precancerous cells on the cervix, by and large, a treatment is recommended. And again, that is because it is much harder for the body to clear moderate and severe precancerous changes, and these have a higher chance of progressing onto cervical cancer. The treatment usually entails some way to either remove the affected cells, the precancerous cells from the cervix, or to ablate them. Ablate means destroy. So destroy the abnormal cells from the cervix. So
remove and destroy.
Yes.
So what's the difference?
So the difference is when you are removing or excising the abnormal cells, you're actually cutting away, you're taking them away from the cervix.
Okay.
Exactly. Okay. It can be done by different means. The most common way is with a wire loop, which is heated with an electric current. This all sounds horrible. You're not going to get electrocuted.
Yeah.
There's nothing like that. But there's a special instrument that is designed for the purpose of performing the procedure to remove the affected cells from the cervix.
Okay.
It sounds very involved, but actually this procedure called LEEP, L-E-E-P, it's an acronym. It stands for a very long term, which I'm not going to say this time.
You don't need to.
So it's a LEEP procedure, and it actually can be done in the office. It usually also takes like 20, maybe 30 minutes. There's some minor local anesthesia that can be administered to the woman to be able to tolerate the procedure. And you get it done, you go home the very same day.
Okay.
It's not anything too involved. I've done many in the office, and many women tolerate it very well. In the office.
In the office.
Exactly.
And they didn't need to sleep over or just in the office.
Exactly.
No surgery, no theater.
Right. Now, in certain instances, I will do it in the theater.
In the theater. Okay.
Not every medical facility, not every office is equipped with the proper equipment or personnel to be able to do it in the office. So in those cases, it is done in the theater. Traditionally, before advances in medicine, it was always done in the theater, okay? But it's only now, because we have, you know, newer instruments, newer ways of doing things, that it can be done in an office setting safely. So the second way to remove the abnormal cells from the cervix is usually with a knife. That's called a cold knife cone biopsy, or cone biopsy to be simple. Usually that is reserved for the case of severe precancerous changes, where you suspect that, okay, there might actually be some early actual cancer present. And so the reason you would do the procedure with a knife instead is because you want the edges of the tissue sample that you remove to be clean, so that they can be easily evaluated by the pathologist, and they can say, okay, yes, there is actually cancer present. Is it invading into deeper tissues or not? Having that clean margin is important for detecting that. Okay. So not all, in that case, the cone biopsy serves not only as a treatment, but also as a diagnostic measure to help you to know if you've gotten everything, if there is cancer there, or if you actually need to go and do a more involved surgery. Okay. With ablation, you're just destroying the cervical cells. And this can actually be done for certain cases of low risk precancerous cells, and some cases of high risk precancerous cells, although current recommendations usually advise that if there's high risk precancer there, it's best to do an actual removal as opposed to a destruction. Because with the destruction, you're not removing anything. You're either just burning the abnormal cells with a laser or by some other technique, or you're freezing them, which is called cryotherapy. But in those cases, you don't really know if you've gotten everything.
If everything is
exactly. So that's why with severe precancerous changes, they usually recommend that you do an actual removal or excision technique for treatment.
That's more sure.
Exactly. It's important to have the actual tissue to know if you've gotten everything or not. Yes.
Okay, after this break, we'll come back to you.
Okay.
Hello, viewers. This has been Ladies Digest, and that's the part two, and we're talking about interpretation of the results and management of your pap test results. You can drop your comments, you can drop your questions on our YouTube and Facebook pages at the Association of African Universities. Do stay tuned.
The Association of African Universities, AAU, under the patronage of His Excellency Abdel Fattah Saheed Hussein Khalil El-Sisi, President of Egypt and current Chairperson of the African Union, and Ahmed Mohamed Ahmed El-Tayeb, the Grand Imam of Al-Azhar, presents the AAU's Conference of Rectors, Vice Chancellors and Presidents of African Universities from 8th to 11th of July 2019. Theme: Role of Higher Education Institutions in Promoting the Continental Education Strategy, CESA 1625. Call for papers have been announced for the following sub-themes: Promoting Science and Mathematics Education, Expanding Technical and Vocational Education and Training Opportunities, Revitalizing and Expanding Tertiary Education, Research and Innovation, Promoting Peace Education and Conflict Prevention at All Levels of Education, Improving Management of Education Systems and Harnessing the Capacity of ICT to Improve Access and Quality of Education and Training, Promoting Mobility Through Harmonization of Quality Assurance and Accreditation Systems, and Identifying New Directions to Improve the Management of Education in Africa. Submit your paper abstracts of not more than 2 pages online at www.aau.org/subs/abstracts. Deadline for submission is 15th March 2019. For further details on CoreWeb 2019, please visit events.aau.org/CoreWeb.
Welcome back, viewers. Before the break, we talked about getting your results, and it's abnormal. You see some abnormal cells. How it's described, how it's evaluated, and the necessary follow-ups to be done. And now we've come back to talk about the follow-ups after the treatment has been done. And I have some questions from my guest, and I want our doctor to treat them, and that'll be all for this session. Welcome back, doctor.
Thank you.
Yeah, so when the treatment is done, I'm clear now from any abnormality, what follow-up is needed?
So being cleared from any abnormality is one instance.
Yeah.
But there may have been abnormalities found for which you needed a procedure, like the leaf, okay, or the comb biopsy, et cetera. Each individual case, like I keep mentioning, the follow-up would be determined based on your doctor, okay, and your specific circumstance. So it's always important to highlight that, because I am oversimplifying in these explanations here. Sure. But in general, if you have an evaluation for abnormal pap, like I mentioned earlier, if you've had a low-grade change on the pap test, you've had the colposcopy and biopsy, the biopsy either shows just normal cells or mild changes, usually a follow-up just includes a repeat pap test with an HPV co-testing in most instances, either in a year or at an interval specified by your physician.
Okay.
The fact that you've had an evaluation means that you may not necessarily return to the every 3 or 5 years.
Okay.
Automatically.
Okay.
But usually you'd have a shorter term follow-up.
Okay.
And then based on that test result, your doctor will advise you on whether you can resume the routine screening interval. Exactly.
Okay.
Age also plays a role in that.
Okay.
Certain cases you may have high grade identified on your pap smear, high grade SIL. Your biopsy may have come back either moderate or severe precancerous cells. If you have had to undergo a definitive treatment procedure, let's say an excision, then typically your follow-up will require additional pap testing, sometimes with or without HPV testing, at a shorter interval than even 1 year.
Okay.
Usually it's every 6 months for a certain duration of time, also specified by your physician,
okay,
until you have a certain number of tests that come back normal, then in those instances, your doctor will advise you when you can go back to routine screening. So all of this is dependent, again, on your age, the type of abnormality you had, the type of treatment you had, and then...
Are there tendencies of these abnormalities recurring?
Sometimes they can.
Okay.
Because again, we talked about sometimes the HPV can be dormant in the cells.
Okay.
The other thing is that, remember, the cervix and vagina, they're kind of contiguous, so they're all attached to each other. You may have one region of the cervix that has severe change. Okay. It doesn't mean that the HPV is just there. The HPV has probably affected all of the cells of the cervix, but you have some severe changes in one area. And so you'll have the treatment procedure to try and include that severe area for certain, and also some of the less severe areas as well.
Okay.
But the remaining cervical cells may still be HPV affected.
Yeah,
they're just not manifesting that severe change in that one area that had to be removed. And so the surveillance after that is to check and see, okay, now that you've had the major disease burden, so to speak, removed, can your body now then clear whatever is remaining, or will it persist and start to cause further abnormalities again?
Okay.
Most of the time, again, after you've had a treatment for severe precancerous changes, if you're young and healthy, your immune system is normal.
Yeah.
Most of the time, you do go back to normal after that.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Wow. Okay, let's just look at some questions
that
our viewers have sent to
us.
One says, can you get cervical cancer without HPV?
You actually can.
Okay.
And there is a medication that had been given back in the 60s, 70s in the U.S. I can't necessarily speak to whether it was used worldwide, called DES. It was a medication given, I think, for nausea, vomiting during pregnancy. Studies showed over the years that that DES caused precancer and cancer of the genital organs of those women's female children.
Wow.
So the women that took it themselves were not at increased risk of, let's say, cervical cancer, for example.
Okay.
But the daughters of the women, the female children that they were carrying
the fetus, kind of,
were found to develop cancers of the anal genital area more frequently in the absence of HPV infection. So in that case, yes, cervical cancer can develop, especially if there had been DES exposure.
Sure.
Most of those women that took DES are now aged, so the daughters of those women we're seeing with less and less frequency. And so we still inquire about it usually at GYN visits, especially if we know that you're in a location where that medication had been given at that time.
Okay,
that medication is not given anymore to anyone. They stopped that long ago.
So we are safe.
So it's not a current risk.
I see.
But because we know of that history, we do ask that, but we're seeing it less and less just because the women of those ages where it would have been given, they're kind of aging out.
Yeah.
So yes, in that case, yes, you can get cervical cancer in the absence of HPV.
Okay, another one goes, does cervical screening test screen for other forms of cancers?
In general, no. Cervical cancer screening, the Pap test, is for the cervix.
Okay.
I do know of some instances where sometimes they can check for other cell abnormalities from other tissues using the Pap test, but in general, it's safe to say that the Pap test is for cervical cancer screening.
Alone.
Yes.
Okay, and another one, having sex with is having sex with a cervical cancer patient safe or advisable?
So someone who actively has cervical cancer?
Yeah. Let's say, for instance, your wife.
Okay.
Yeah, a man.
So usually by the time you get to the stage of cervical cancer, you are starting to manifest certain symptoms. In general.
You are not even healthy.
Well, not necessarily.
Okay.
Cervical cancer also has different stages. As you can see, all these things we're talking about have stages,
low grade,
high grade, CIN 1 to 3. Cancer also has stages. You can have an early stage cancer where you won't necessarily have like a mass growing on the cervix, but the cells can be abnormal enough where, say, if you are sexually active, you may start to have some abnormal bleeding. Cervical cancer can also be advanced. Usually in that case, you are very sick. You can have a lot of pelvic pain. You can have other manifestations in the body, because when cervical cancer becomes advanced, it tends to spread to other organs. So now you're manifesting other very severe symptoms where you probably will not really be interested in
sexual activity
anyway.
Okay.
Also, sexual activity, especially penetration, with someone who has advanced cervical cancer is not advisable, because there can be life-threatening bleeding that results from that, especially if there's an actual mass in the cervix. And interestingly, I shouldn't necessarily say that you may not be interested. Some women have cervical cancer and they're not aware. They may be manifesting symptoms, but they don't recognize it as this could be cervical cancer.
Not going for the
exactly. So maybe they're having a heavier discharge than normal, or they're seeing just like some little bleeding here and there at other times apart from their menses. They're having some pelvic pain, but they're not associating that could be cervical cancer. I'm not saying if you have those symptoms of cervical cancer. Most of the time, if you have symptoms like that, it's usually something else. But sometimes you can have those types of symptoms with cervical cancer. And so if you actually have intercourse with that being the case, there can be excessive bleeding, which can be life-threatening. So if you have someone who you know has cervical cancer, or there's suspicion for that, it's probably best to refrain from that. When you have cervical cancer and you're being treated, usually the treatment is very involved. And this, I'm talking about severe cervical cancer. Maybe you've had, surgery or whatever to treat, or maybe you're having chemotherapy, which can be used for cervical cancer. Usually you are not feeling that great, and so the likelihood that you're sexually active during those times, just because of, the intensity of the treatment, is not likely that you're being sexually active at that time.
So before I go back to the other questions, how harmful is cervical cancer?
And I'm sorry, to be clear, penetrative sex is what I'm talking about in terms of having, with someone who has cervical cancer. But obviously there's other ways of being intimate as well. Those are perfectly fine as long as the woman is feeling
comfortable
up to it. Exactly.
Okay. How harmful is cervical cancer?
Cervical cancer kills people. Wow. Yes, it is one of the leading causes of mortality or death worldwide. But like for somewhere, let's say the US, for example, because we have these screening methods in place, or any region where they have these screening methods in place, cervical cancer has gone from being one of the leading causes of death amongst women to being much lower down on the scale of the causes of death. Exactly, because it's being detected earlier, it's being managed earlier, it's being prevented, because you're catching things early when they're more easily managed. Yes, but cervical cancer is extremely harmful because people can die from it. Yes.
Okay. Someone says, is having oral sex with someone with HPV putting you at risk?
Yes.
Okay.
So oral sex is still skin-to-skin contact. It's all skin.
Skin, your lip is skin.
Yes. Yeah, and so remember I said earlier, if you're thinking about high-risk HPV, not only does it cause cervical cancer, it also can cause cancers of the head and neck, specifically the mouth and the throat. There was a celebrity, and I'm not going to mention the name because I don't want to say the wrong thing, but he actually came out and said that he had had throat cancer and it was associated with HPV.
Yeah.
So in that instance, yes, there can be a risk there. Again, I keep highlighting that for young, healthy people, most of the time, HPV does not amount to these types of development of cancer in general. However, selectivity in your sexual partners, even condom use, there are female condoms as well. So you can, there are female condoms where you can put it on and still perform the oral sex. And that can be a preventative measure. The vaccine, if you fall within the appropriate age range, that can also be a preventative measure. And then selectivity with the sexual partners.
Cleanliness in general, can it contribute in any way to reducing HPV?
Not necessarily.
Okay.
Because you get HPV only through sexual transmission. So good hygiene is always advisable, just for your general vaginal health. But just general vaginal cleanliness does not necessarily increase your risk of acquiring HPV infection.
Okay, and our last question. This is obviously from a lady. It says, does foreplay put a lady at a risk to contracting HPV?
Yes. Okay. And that's for both the low risk and high risk types of HPV. Okay. Because again, we're talking about skin-to-skin contact. That's how HPV is transmitted. And so, for example, like I said, even with low-risk HPV, which we know causes genital warts, a person may have low-risk HPV in the cells of the genital area. For a man, for example, not just on the penis, but also on the general genital area. So if there is, you know, contact between the genitalia, or even between the genitalia then through fingers to the woman or to the male or whatever, there is risk of transmitting the virus in that way. With high risk HPV, because it's usually affecting the cervix, yes, it's usually tends to be through penetrative sex.
Yeah.
But you know, if for example you are manually stimulating a woman internally in the vagina to the cervix, and you know there are high risk HPV affected cells in other places, you can spread it there as well. So as long as you're skin to skin contact with someone who has HPV, there is a risk of acquiring it, both low risk and high risk HPV.
Finally, your final word to our viewers, emphasizing the need for them not to be too scared of going for the test.
Definitely don't be scared of coming for a routine GYN visit, getting the Pap test and the HPV. Today we talked about a lot of, you know, technical terms and long words and procedures which sound very scary and intimidating and very involved. But in general, they tend to be fairly minor in the sense that they are simple tests that can detect disorders early, disorders specifically meaning precancerous cells early before they have a chance to get to actual cancer. Undergoing these tests, especially the additional tests if you have an abnormality found on the Pap test, can be nerve-wracking. So I'm not saying that you shouldn't be worried or shouldn't be nervous. And any questions that you have, certainly take them to your doctors. Better to ask and get your questions answered sufficiently to allay your fears and reassure you that everything is being done appropriately to evaluate what's going on, than to be so fearful that it stops you from going and getting the evaluation you need.
If possible, kills you.
Exactly. It's because certainly treating cervical cancer is much more difficult and much more involved, and usually leads to much more side effects and problems than getting evaluated and treated for these changes that we can see on the Pap smear or with the cervical biopsy. So again, always highlighting prevention, always encouraging communication. You know, even if you're scared or even if you're worried about certain things, it's better to go get your questions answered, get the appropriate testing, and know for a fact that you know what's going on and that it's being managed, rather than not know and potentially develop a serious or even deadly problem in the future.
So as doctor has said, prevention, prevention.
Very important.
It's better. Ask questions, talk, instead of staying in the dark, and it will lead to more serious issues and maybe, if possible, incurable situation. This has been Ladies Digest, and have been your host, Iyoa John Ikwea, and we had in our midst our regular guest who has left a very busy schedule to come and teach us, to come and sensitize us on this very, very sensitive issue, cervical cancer, and the need to go for a test, a Pap test. So it will come your way same time next week. Do stay tuned.
Are you an institution or individual? Do you intend to organize a memorable event to be archived for future reference? Then look no further than AAU Studios, because it's your best bet. With our spacious studio and state-of-the-art media equipment such as 4K Panasonic video cameras, KinoFlow lights, assorted microphones, live streaming equipment, among others, you are sure to get the best of productions. Visit us at Trinity Avenue, East Legon, adjacent the National Accreditation Board, or contact the AAU Studios via the following email addresses: info@aau.org, aautv@aau.org, or ransford@aau.org. Alternatively, you can call us on +233 244 736280.
Welcome to another edition of Impact Stories, which is dedicated to celebrating academic mentors. This program is running on AAU TV, and I am the host of the program. My name is Ransford Bequim. Follow the discussions on the dedicated website and also on the social media handles on the screen. I am here in Accra to talk to an agriculturist who is also a forest and horticultural specialist at the University of Ghana. But we are going on a short break, and when we come back, I will introduce the guest. Welcome back to Impact Stories on AAU TV. Follow the discussions on all the social media handles on the screen and on our dedicated website, tv.aau.org. I am here at the CSIR to talk to an agriculturist, but more specifically, he's a forest and horticultural specialist who has trained out of Africa, but is back in Ghana to give back to the continent. He's no other person but Professor Samuel Ejayi Insia. Welcome to Impact Stories, Prof.
Thank you, sir.
How are you doing?
I'm doing very well.
Great. Prof, I am informed you trained out of Ghana.
Yes.
But currently, you are the immediate past head of the Forest and Horticultural Crop Research Center of the School of Agriculture, College of Basic and Applied Sciences, University of Ghana, Legon. I hope this is right.
Yes.
Great. Before we delve deeper into what you do here, can you give us a little bit about your beginnings? A little bit about your beginnings.
Okay. I was born about 56 years ago. At Barakese, in Ashanti region of Ghana, where I also had my primary school education. Okay. In 1979, I wrote common entrance examination and passed and began my secondary school education at the Konongo Odumase Secondary School at Odumase, near Konongo, in Ashanti Achim Central District of the Ashanti region of Ghana. I studied at the Konongo Odumase Secondary School between 1979 and 1984 for my O-level certificate examination, and then continued at the same school from 1984 to 1986 for my A-level. From there, I proceeded to the Kwame Nkrumah University of Science and Technology,
right,
Kumasi, to study BSc Agriculture.
BSc Agriculture. Okay.
Majoring in crop science.
Right.
Then I had an opportunity to do my national service, post-university national service, at the Forest and Horticultural Crop Research Center at Kede. By then, it was known as Agricultural Research Station.
Okay. Okay.
In 1991.
Okay.
I completed a national service in August 1992. I thought that I would be employed at the research center to work as a research assistant. But fortunately or unfortunately, the head of the center at that time, Professor Kwame Afrinuama, advised me to proceed to the university to do my master's degree.
Okay.
I was not very happy because I wanted to work to support my family because I was brought up by my mother.
Okay.
My father died whilst I was about 12 years old. And my mother struggled to take me through my secondary school education. So I thought that now that I had finished my university education, first degree, I should work and then support my mother too. But reluctantly, I took up the advice and bought a form. And then I got admission in 1992, September, and started my Master of Philosophy degree in agriculture, majoring in crop science again.
Okay, but before you proceed, you've made some very interesting revelations talking about your mother raising you at the age of 12 and thereabout. Yeah. How many were you in the family?
We were six boys.
Six strong boys?
Yes, and I was the fifth one.
Okay.
And my father died when I was about 12 years old. And even though my mother had never been to school, he had a strong interest in education. And he decided to spend all that he had on me to educate me.
Wow.
Yes.
And what about the others?
The others, at the time my father died, were three who were in school. The others had completed school.
Okay.
My senior brother, who was before me, was in secondary school, was in form three when my father died. And then my father also, when my father died, I was in class, I had just completed classes.
Right.
And I had another younger brother who was immediately after me.
Mm-hmm.
He was also in class three when our father died.
Okay.
So the three of us were in school. And my mother was a farmer.
Okay.
A cocoa farmer, a peasant farmer, a smallholder farmer.
Ooh.
But he struggled to do all kinds of jobs to make sure that we were catered for as far as our education was concerned.
Okay.
Yes.
But then let me just delve back into this. Was the cost of living very high then, during your time?
Yes, it was very high. At the time I was going to school, that was in 1979, when the our former president, the late had just
staged his coup.
Yes.
Right.
And things like provisions, sugar, toiletries.
Those essentials.
Yes, were not common in those days.
Very true.
We had to queue before we could even buy some of these things to school.
Mm.
Yes. In those days, while in a queue, the army would come and then bundle all of you into a vehicle to go and work in the bush to transport cocoa.
Wow.
Yes.
So did that influence your choice of entering into agriculture as a profession?
It was not that thing that influenced me, but because my father and mother were both farmers.
Right.
And when I started school, my father had died and I was staying with my mother. And he was a farmer and all the time I had to accompany her to farm. So I developed interest in agriculture right from my infancy.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
So that informed me of my choice of agriculture as a subject for study at the university.
Okay.
In fact, when I entered secondary school, I did science. My main aim was to proceed to the university to do agricultural science.
Right.
Yes.
Okay. So in secondary school, were you in any leadership position? And also, did any person mentor you as you wanted to do agriculture science? Because there were other options. There were the general arts and the business programs.
Yes. Nobody mentored me as such, but I was looking up to others who had done agriculture.
Okay.
And were in the research institutes, doing research and promoting agricultural production in the country. So at that time, not many people were doing agriculture at the university.
Okay.
People like doing medicine, pharmacy, and other sciences, but not agriculture. And even when I completed my sixth form and I wanted to go to university, people advised me to go and do pharmacy. Mm. But that was not my interest.
Okay.
I wanted to do agriculture. So after sixth form, I proceeded to Kwame Nkrumah University of Science and Technology to do agriculture.
Right.
Yes.
Okay. So at the university, what was the course duration? 3 years?
At that time, we were doing agriculture at Kwame Nkrumah University of Science and Technology for 4 years.
Okay.
But at Lagos, it was 3 years.
Okay, but you opted for Kwame Nkrumah University?
Yes.
Right.
Not because the agri there was better than that of Lagos, but because it was closer.
Mm, proximity to you.
Yes.
You were still living at the Barrikes?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Yes, and at any time I could go home. And also, when I was at the university, because my mother was the one who was taking care of me, during the holidays, I would go home and then farm.
Okay.
Yes. Before then, I had done my national service with the Ministry of Food and Agriculture, the post sixth form national service.
Right.
So I also developed interest in farming.
Okay.
Particularly maize. So during the holidays, I'll farm maize, and then when I harvest the proceeds, I'll store it for some time, and then sell, and use part of the money to buy things that I needed for school. In those days, we were not paying fees.
Okay.
Yes, even when I started the university, during the first year, we were even being fed.
By the university,
3 times a day.
Mm. 3 square meals
a day, and it was good.
It was good, it should be good.
And it was after the first year that they introduced the SNIT loan.
Okay.
Yes. So I applied for the SNIT loan. At that time, I think it was 50,000 cedis. Not present day 50,000 cedis. The old 50,000 cedis. Yes. It will be about like 50 pesos today.
No.
Yes.
Okay.
But it was good money.
It was good money.
Yes.
Okay.
At that time.
Okay.
So during the holidays, I'll go and then farm maize and then sell and then use it to
buy some essentials.
Yes. Okay. And also whilst in school, after getting the loan, the 50,000 loan, I will also use the proceeds from the sales of my produce to also support my living at the university.
But were you buying textbooks?
Yeah, we're buying textbooks.
Okay.
Yes, we're buying textbooks. We're also, from the second year going, we're buying our own food. Yes.
Because of the loan scheme.
Yes. Okay. The only thing that we're not paying for was accommodation and tuition.
Right.
Yes.
Okay, let me ask. You said Lagos was doing a 3-year program.
Yes.
And Kwame Nkrumah was doing a 4-year program.
Yes.
In terms of the pedagogical approach, was there some kind of internship at KNUST that made you do 4 years?
Yes. First year, long vacation, we will do vacation training at the university. Then the second year, they will take us around to tour all the agricultural facilities in the country.
Mm.
And then the final year, they will attach us to institutions to do attachments.
Okay.
Yes. But I think that was not the reason why it was four years.
Years.
Yes. At that time, were having the semester system at Kwame Nkrumah University of Science and Technology, whilst Legon was following the term system. Yes.
Right.
Three terms. We were having two academic semesters. Yes.
Right. I see the difference.
Yeah.
So you proceeded from Kwame Nkrumah University. You did your post degree national service.
Yeah.
And
yes.
And then you were advised to do your master's.
Yes.
Okay. So what happened?
So I went to West of Ghana Legon School of Agriculture.
Okay.
To do MPhil in crop science.
Right.
Yes.
So how many years?
It was 2 years.
2 years.
But somewhere along the line, there was a strike.
Oh, by so the, you were a victim of the student strikes?
Yes.
Was it the one in 1993?
Yes, yes, I think so. Oh, yes. Yes, yes.
Okay.
Yes. Hmm. So instead of the 2 years, it took me about 3 years before. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
But you managed to complete your MPhil.
Yes. So when I was doing my MPhil, at that time we had Ghana Government Scholarship. And then the SNIT loan. So I took the two.
The two together.
Yes.
Okay.
And that
that's
was
good.
What I used for my, to pay for my living expenses, because we're not paying fees. We're not paying academic use facility fee. We're also not paying for rent.
Okay.
Yes. So everything was okay.
All you needed was to
take care something of to take care of yourself.
All right.
Yes.
Okay. Right. So when you finished your MPhil, you entered into the world of work.
Yes. Before I could even submit my thesis, I got an appointment with the International Institute of Tropical Agriculture, IIT.
Okay. What did they do?
At that time, they were implementing a plantain project in Ghana, in West Africa. It was called West African Plantain Project.
Okay.
And they were looking for an agronomist, and they advertised in the newspapers for about 6 months.
For a position?
Yes, an agronomist with MPhil degree.
Okay.
Yes, but at that time, an agronomist, a plantain agronomist,
mm-hmm.
yes, who has MPhil degree. For 6 months, they couldn't get anybody.
Why?
Because people normally want to do short-term crops, short-duration crops, like maize, cowpea, and legumes, so that they can complete their masters within a very short time. Right. Plantain is more or less a perennial crop.
Exactly.
So you have to spend 2 years before
you can collect
your data.
Data, that's true.
And then write your thesis.
Mm.
And the thesis will also take you another one year. So 3 years.
Did the strike action help you?
Yeah, somehow.
Okay.
So I used about 3 years to do the field work to get my complete data.
So you did the field work on plantain?
I did 1 year coursework.
Yeah.
And then did 2 year
field work. Right.
And that was 3 years.
Mm.
Uh-huh. So in those days, only few people would do such.
3 years.
Yes.
3 years.
Yeah, because you want to do 2 years.
And then be done with it.
Yes, and go and look for a job to do.
Yeah. And looking at you from, you know, your background, you should have quickly finished and then gone back.
Yes, but
now we have a passion.
Yes. So I decided to do it. Three years, I was still collecting data.
Mm.
And writing my thesis. But before I could even submit my thesis, they advertised this position. People asked me to apply. I said, no, I haven't finished my thesis, so I won't apply. So when they couldn't get anybody, then the principal collaborator of the project, Professor Kwame Afrinuema, suggested to the project coordinator to contact me to see if I could help. So I was in the field one day collecting data when the project coordinator came to the field. He was a German lady, and he came and talked to me. He was interviewing me, and I didn't know.
Mm. Just the informal discussion was an interview.
Yes, it was an interview, but I didn't know.
Right.
So when he finished, then she told me why he came there.
Mm.
At that time, they had started the project and they were looking for, he was looking for somebody to assist him, research associate.
Right.
So I told her that, yes, I'm interested, but I'm still a student, so I'll not be able to take up the position. So she begged, said, oh, okay, if you won't take the position, fine, but I have some staff here, and I'm traveling, so I'll give you short-term contract to supervise them till I come back.
Wow.
So I said, okay, yes, I will do that. So that was in 1994 or so.
Right.
So I took up a short-term appointment for about 3 months.
Mm-hmm.
When he came back, he was satisfied with the work I had done.
Wow,
so then he said, oh, then I want to give you a permanent appointment. So I said, okay. So I accepted the appointment and then worked with her whilst I was putting things in place to submit my thesis. So I submitted my thesis. Then I started working with the project. The project ran for about 5 years, till 1999.
Okay.
So when the project ended in 1999, and I applied to the university, and I was appointed as a research fellow at the center, and the agricultural research station at that time, which is now the Forest and Horticultural Crop Research Center.
Mm.
Yes.
Okay, we'll go on a short break, and when we come back, we're going to explore your adventures at the university and whether you have left the university. This is AAU Impact Stories, which is streaming on AAU TV. And I'm talking to Professor Ajay Insia, who is an agronomist and he's done so much. He has actually traversed from a poor farmer's son into a very big and celebrated agronomist. Stay tuned. Welcome back to Impact Stories on AAU TV, the voice of higher education in Africa. I've been talking to Professor Samuel Ejensia, and we left off when he had just been appointed at the University of Ghana to pursue his professional career. So, Prof, tell us more about your career at the University of Ghana.
When I joined the university in October 1999.
You remember the dates?
Yes.
Wow.
1st October 1999.
Okay.
I started looking for scholarship to go and do my PhD outside Ghana. So in 2002, January, I got a scholarship from the Netherlands government to pursue a 4-year PhD program at the Wageningen University in the Netherlands. At that time, it was an agricultural university.
Okay.
Yes. And the program I joined was called Convergence of Sciences. That means converging both social and then biological science or technical science.
Okay.
Now, my background was a technical science. Or biological scientist, an agronomist.
Mm-hmm.
But this time around, I had to combine it with social science and extension.
Okay.
And I was supposed to look at how farmers' practices are influenced by social issues.
Right.
Yes. It all started when a team of scientists from the University of Ghana went to do research in the forest savanna transitional zone in Wenchi.
Okay. In Ghana.
Yes. During the interaction, the farmers told them that soil fertility decline was a major constraint. And therefore, what they do to overcome that constraint was to use cassava to regenerate the soil.
The soil.
Wow. That is when the soil, the fertility of the soil
reduces.
Then they will crop the land to cassava. And then after 16 months, they will harvest the cassava. And by the time they harvested the cassava, the soil would have improved.
This is indigenous knowledge.
Indigenous knowledge, but it was it conflicted with scientific
science.
Belief.
Right.
Because according to science, cassava is a heavy feeder. Mm-hmm. And it's one of the crops that feeds heavily on the soil. So by the time you harvest the cassava, there will be nothing left in the soil to grow other crops. So they said that then I should take it up and investigate and find out why that was so. I went to the university. I interacted with some of the professors in the university. During one of our meetings, one person said that, no, this can never be true. Because we all know that cassava is a heavy feeder.
Right.
And it extracts a lot of nutrients from the soil. So how can it regenerate soil fertility? Then the following day, when we had a meeting, one professor brought a book somebody had written, which suggests that cassava is able to feed deeper into the soil and bring up nutrients that have been leached out of the root zone onto the surface of the soil through litter falls when the leaves fall.
Right. That's interesting.
Yes. So when you plant any other crop, the crop will benefit.
Okay.
So they say, then this is worth investigating.
Exactly. So that was, sense of research.
Yes. So that was the beginning of my PhD study. But because it was an indigenous knowledge, I had to study the cropping system of the farmers to be able to understand very well what they do and the reason they do that. So I did some social science courses for 6 months at the Wageningen University.
Okay.
So I stayed with the social I stayed with the social science group of the university, and then did some courses in social science.
Okay. To study human behavior.
Human behavior and other things, and extension methodology, and how to work with farmers and other things.
Right.
So I didn't do any agronomic work or.
But just the social sciences.
Social science. So I came back to Ghana. I went to Wenchi. Then I work in three communities, Droboso, Esuano, and Biposo. There are three adjoining communities.
Right.
I stayed there for 4 years.
You stayed?
In the community for 4 years.
No, Prof, but your PhD was supposed to be
four years. So I stayed there for 3.5 years.
Right.
Yes. So I was studying how they were doing their work, their farming activities.
Okay.
And I will interview them. Sometimes I will interview them without they knowing it, that I was interviewing them. Sometimes I will go to the community, they will invite me to come and eat. I will eat with them, and in the course of eating, I will converse with them. And then I was trying to understand what they were doing. And they will give me any information that I will need. Without
them knowing
what the information they were giving to me. So every 3 months I'll organize a stakeholder meeting and invite
them.
Yes, and invite other stakeholders in the agriculture value chain, farmers, buyers and other things. And then I will narrate whatever I learned from the community to them. And sometimes the community members will be surprised. Some of the information they have divulged to me without knowing it.
Wow.
Yes.
That's interesting.
Yes. So after staying there for about 3.5 years, I had collected all my data. I was also carried out research with them on their own fields and developed several technologies with them. Just to technology that will enable them to improve their soil fertility.
Sure.
And there were a lot of lantana issues that also prevent some section of the community from also practicing some of the
technologies
My studies also delve into lantana issues. So at the end of my 4 years, I went back to Wageningen University to write my thesis for 6 months.
Okay.
So I came back and then graduated.
Okay. So it means that I didn't even have time to learn the language.
No. It was an international university.
Okay.
They were also learning English, so they will not even teach you their language. They will also
want to learn from you.
Yes, from you, the English language.
Because I was going to ask you, how do you say, how are you? Okay.
So, right. Yes. Mm. So when I came back,
was Legon ready for you?
Yes, it was. Legon was ready for me. But when I was doing the PhD, a lot of people didn't understand the program very well. People were saying that you are a trained agronomist. But what you went there to do was more or less extension. So how can you fit into the system here?
Again.
So I remember when I came back, my head told me that he collected my thesis, the papers I had written, and said, when I look at your thesis, what you went to do was more or less extension. So why don't you transfer to Agricultural Extension Department in Legon to teach Agricultural Extension? Then I said, no, what I went there to do was not extension. The extension was only to help me to understand the farmers better.
Sure.
Yes. So, and that was the first time that course was being introduced, were the first batch. So people actually did not understand the concept.
Exactly.
But we had a second phase of the project where we trained more students.
Okay.
In fact, the first phase of the program was being implemented by three countries. Two countries, Ghana and Benin. And then the second phase of the program was implemented by Mali, Benin, and Ghana.
Right.
The idea was that we had developed so much technologies, but farmers were not using them.
Yeah.
So we thought that if you develop the technology with the farmers, then they will be able to use them.
This brings to my mind the issue of research dissemination.
Yes.
Most times we have research, very, very good research outcomes. That remains grey literature because the end users don't benefit. Rather, we publish in high-impact journals and get our awards, and then the people to implement are not there.
No, this is because of the reward system in the universities and the research institutions.
I agree with you, Prof.
Yes, my promotion does not depend on how many farmers have eradicated from poverty. But it depends on many papers, yes, I've been able to publish.
So how can we really change the system?
So that was the reason why we wanted to work with farmers, do research with farmers on their own field, so that we don't need any intermediary to transfer the technology to them.
Right.
But that didn't work. Why? I helped the farmers to produce so much maize and cassava that they couldn't even get market.
Oh, goodness.
So the issue was not about technology. But the issue was about institutions. Farmers did not have access to credit. Farmers did not have access to input. Farmers did not have access to market. So even if you help farmers to produce so much, they don't have buyers.
And then the prices will fall.
Yes. If you introduce technology to farmers, if you ask farmers to use fertilizer, yes, farmers can use fertilizer, they will increase their yield. But where do they get the fertilizer? Because they don't have access to credit.
Okay.
Even when he has access to credit to buy the fertilizer and he puts, who is to buy?
The storage systems had failed.
Yes.
Right.
So this thing also did not work. So in the second phase, then we decided to tackle institutional challenges.
From lessons learned.
Yes.
Okay, that's fine.
So in the next phase, we try to work with farmers, all the stakeholders, to solve farmers' problems.
Sure.
Yes. And so through that, then we realize that before we can facilitate farmers to adopt technologies, then we have to facilitate partnerships with other stakeholders along the value chain so that farmers can get access to input, credits, mechanization services, and also market. So now we are talking about innovation system. We are talking about value chain concepts. We are talking about PPP.
Yes.
So from there, all the projects that I've been running, we try to use those
all the
concepts.
Yeah.
Yes, concepts. So we've been facilitating partnerships around access to credit, input and output market, finances, mechanization, all those things, to enable farmers to actually adopt innovations or adopt technologies.
Right.
So technology is not an innovation until all the other components are also in place.
Okay, I agree. Well, with this marvelous, you know, you've intervened so well. Did you even provide some consultancies to other institutions, maybe within or out of Ghana?
Yes.
You did?
Yes. I've consulted for FAO.
Right, that's a big one.
Yes. I also consulted for IITA on several occasions. I've also consulted for Wageningen University.
Oh,
yes.
Your alma mater.
Yes. I've also consulted for Ministry of Food and Agriculture, Ghana, and also USAID.
So can you count your publications?
I have about over 60 journal articles.
Wow. That's marvelous. Any awards, special awards?
These are the two awards that I've received from the International Institute of Tropical Agriculture when I implemented one of their projects called Into Africa.
So currently, what are you doing? You are nearing your retirement age at the University of Ghana.
Yes. In 2014, I took leave of absence from the university and joined the International Institute of Tropical Agriculture to coordinate one of their big projects in Africa, which was implemented in 5 countries in Africa: Ghana, Nigeria, Ethiopia, Uganda, and Tanzania.
Okay.
So when I was about to finish that project, we developed a concept note and we submitted to NORAD.
Okay.
Yes.
The Norwegians.
Yes.
Okay.
For funding. They were going to give us some funds to implement the project when the COVID came.
Oh, okay.
So just last year, they asked us to submit. We submit the concept note.
Right.
Then we submitted it. They gave us some funds to implement the project on soybean.
Okay.
Now, soybean has become a cash crop in northern Ghana.
Oh.
And it's now an export crop. It's a major ingredient in the preparation of animal feed, including poultry feed. And it's as a result of lack of inadequate soybean and maize that the poultry industry is almost
collapsing
now. So we are facilitating partnerships among the actors along the value chain to stay up production so that we can get some for our industries and also export some.
Yes.
So that's currently the work. That, so
more importantly, local consumption.
Yes. So in September, 1st September, I took up another leave of absence from the university to help coordinate this project.
Wow.
So that is what I'm currently doing here. The project is being implemented in the five northern regions of Ghana.
Prof, you seem to be a very busy man. Do you have any leisure?
Yes.
You do?
Yes.
What do you do when you are having your leisure time?
No, gardening.
You gardening?
I have a very big backyard garden.
But you have a farm as well, a big...
Yeah, yeah. I used to have farm, but because of time, yes, I've given them out.
Okay.
Yes.
But you do gardening?
Yeah, I do gardening at my backyard. So when I go to my backyard, I have everything.
It's like an orchard.
I have plantain, I have cocoyam.
If you have plantain, it's a farm.
Yes. I have vegetables. So when I go home at any time and I say I want to eat, I don't have to go to market to buy anything.
So going home, you have a wife and how many
children? I have a wife and four children,
okay.
Three girls and one boy.
Okay. And some of them are taking after you?
Only one.
Only one?
Only one is studying agriculture at the university.
Okay.
Yes, he's in level 300.
Okay.
One also is doing communication.
Right.
Communication science.
Okay.
One of the universities in Germany. One also did French and linguistics.
Right.
And then master's in applied corporate management. He just completed and came to Ghana.
Okay.
Yes.
That's a happy home.
And the last one is now in senior high school.
Okay.
And second year.
Okay. So what is your favorite dish?
Oh, ampesi.
Okay.
Plantain.
Prepared by yourself?
Plantain and then contumery.
Prepared by madam?
Yes.
But can you cook?
I can also cook.
Wow. I see. I guess you are a Christian.
Yes.
Which denomination?
I'm a Presbyterian and also a Methodist.
Munsro.
Yamineo.
Good.
Yes.
Okay. So you are MPU. Allegon, is it Methodist Presbyterian Union?
Yes.
Okay. Now when your let me ask about sports. Are you interested in sports?
Not so much.
But should you choose any sporting activity, which one will you be interested in?
Maybe football.
Football. Local or international?
Local.
Local, coming from the Ashanti region,
that
I guess.
Kotoko.
Wow. Okay. Now I can see that your children are grown up now.
Yes.
And you've written over 60 publications.
Yes.
Are you writing fables for your children or any story? Any story books, anything for the children, apart from the scientific writings?
No.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right. Now you have the platform to advise the young people who are building careers.
Yes.
What will you have to say to them?
Yes. You see, some people do not actually understand the programs and the courses that they choose, even at the secondary school,
okay,
and at the university. And so they end up completing school without being satisfied with the courses and programs that they did. So they need guidance in selecting courses.
Right
from the senior high school to the university. For instance, a lot of people want to do agriculture at the university, but then they do agri at the senior high school. But agriculture at the university is a pure science. So instead of doing agriculture at the senior high school, they should rather do science.
Right.
Basic science. Because agriculture is an applied science.
It's an applied
science. We normally have a lot of problem with those who come from the senior high school with the agricultural background to come and do agriculture at the university.
But they don't fit.
They don't fit very well.
Yes.
They have problem with mathematics, chemistry, and physics. And so at the university, we are planning to have people to teach them the basic sciences during the first year, because they cannot cope with the basic sciences that we teach them
at the tertiary level. Right.
And so I always advise, when I get an opportunity, I advise those young children who go to second school and they are, who are choose their course at the senior high school. If you want to do agri at the university, do basic science.
So this is where we draw the curtains to this intriguing episode of Impact Stories on AAU TV. Stay tuned in for other programs.
Hey, so this is Dishant from Unica University Common Application. I recommend you to watch AAU television.
AAU TV is the place to be for every person in higher education in Africa. Better be there or be nowhere.
Continue to regarder la télé et surtout sur le AAU.
Keep watching it and it will change the way you interact with higher education on the continent. AAU, great job.
I want to tell you that AAU television is fantastic. It's educative, it's informative, and it is a must for anybody who is interested in higher education in Africa.
When I was in Accra last year, I did an interview on this TV. It's a very important mouthpiece.
It's a data, it's a bank of all we need for the development of higher education in Africa.
People should make an effort to view it because it discusses very current issues of development across the continent.
I believe that the station will continue to promote the overall development of Africa, particularly in the tertiary education sector.
AAU TV provides a platform and shares a lot of information to a broader audience. So we wish you all the best and please continue serving.
AAU TV,
the voice of higher education in Africa.
Africa, welcome to another exciting episode of the CGC show. Remember, the show is proudly brought to you by the Association of African Universities, and we are coming to you live from the headquarters of AAU Accra, Ghana, and I am your host, Ajo Omi. Do follow us on our social media platforms at AAU_TV, on Twitter, Association of African Universities, on Facebook and YouTube, and at AAU TV Official on Instagram. Many thanks to GTP Fabric for my beautiful fabric, and of course Majestic Outfit for my beautiful dress, and AJ Makeover GH for my beautiful makeup. I have my guest here with me, and today we will be discussing cabin crew as a career path. I'll introduce her after the break. Stay tuned. Ismaila Bashira. She is a cabin crew and an entrepreneur, and of course, she will definitely tell us how she does the two at a time. Ismaila, welcome on the show.
Hi, Adra. How are you?
I'm good fine, to see thank you. Finally. Yeah, I know, right? I was actually really, really grateful that you were able to make time to come on the show, since you are almost always traveling all around the world.
I'm happy to be here as well.
Thank you. Adra. So tell us, what do you do as a cabin crew?
Well, a cabin crew is somebody that works in an aircraft, basically.
Okay.
But basically, in the cabin of the aircraft, we try to.
Oh, so it's not the whole aircraft, it's just the cabin.
Yeah, that's why.